For Krima Media's Polity, I'm Sanel Dlamini, director at Brandhurst Foundation, and author Greg Mills discusses the book titled Democracy Works, Rewiring Politics to Africa's Advantage. Your recent book, Democracy Works, quotes a Ghanaian proverb which says, one head alone is not enough to decide. Tell us about your collaboration with authors like President Olusegun Obasanjo, Jeff Herbst, as well as Tendai Biti in writing this book.
Well, I'm a firm believer in the power of that proverb, of course, and the outcomes. President Obasanjo is the chairman of the Brandhurst Foundation, so he's an obvious person to collaborate with, and he brings a huge amount of personal experience in diplomacy and, of course, most importantly, in the democratic transitions that Nigeria has undertaken itself. He was the military ruler, which he became by default when his predecessor was assassinated in the mid-1970s. He was the military ruler who oversaw the transition to democracy in 1979 in Nigeria. And then again, he, after a spell in prison, and of course being a pro-democracy activist during the time of the regime of Sani Abacha, he went and became the first democratically elected president in 1999 for two terms. So he brings a wealth of experience. Jeffrey Herbst and I have collaborated since we were PhD students, some 30 years ago. So, and he's also a member of the board of the foundation. And then Tendai Biti, I've got to know over the last 10, 15 years, given his role in Zimbabwe, was part of an advisory group when he was Minister of Finance in the coalition government in Zimbabwe. And we've kept in touch, and these issues are very close to our own personal hearts. So it's sometimes quite difficult to manage a collaboration, but not in this particular instance. Everybody brought different strengths to the table, and we've all worked very well together. So it is a fieldwork-based volume. It speaks of the personal experiences of individuals, so it's based on a considerable number of interviews, more than 300 interviews, in fact. So if you just think of the logistics of conducting 300 interviews and the time involved, and that helps to have a more than just one, simply one author, to enable that, and it makes the review process of the manuscript that much more interesting, and I hope but the readers will determine this, it makes the manuscript itself more interesting.
What is the state of democracy in Africa?
Well, that's an excellent question. So if you look at over the longer sweep of history, we've gone from a period of independence, of course, in the 1960s, when you had a whole range of democratic governments, then which were overtaken by a combination of military coup d'etats, one-party regime systems, to the point in the early 1980s when there were just two countries classified by Freedom House as being free. And since that time, of course, you've seen an increase. With the end of the Cold War, there was a notable uptick in the number of democracies. And today, more than 40 African countries regularly hold multi-party elections. That, of course, doesn't mean that they are free. It means that they hold multi-party elections, which is just but one criteria in this process. And, of course, the freeness of those different elections varies from country to country as well. So today, 10 countries are classified as being free, 22 partly free and 22 unfree. So that's a significant advance from the 1980s. Is it what we need? No. Is it what the majority of Africans expect? No, because two-thirds of African citizens prefer democracy to any other sort of system, which is a very important statistic in all of this. It's not that Africans want a different system of government. Democracy is the system of government that they want. So it's a long process of consolidation. We've kind of got stuck as of the moment around these figures of 10, 22, and 22. And there's very little variation between these different categories. And so the book is about trying to understand why it is that some countries get stuck and why it is that some countries are able to consolidate their democracies and build the sorts of institutions that are necessary, and then why some countries regress. Zambia, Mali, for example, why have they regressed over time and fallen from the free into the partly free category in both instances?
Can you also unpack why democracy relies on much more than having free and fair elections?
Well, it's a bit like the answer, you know, what does Africa need to succeed? Yes, it needs strong leadership. Leadership that's able to make difficult choices and pursue those choices in spite of the short-term political consequences. We see this in South Africa at the moment with regard to Eskom and to other difficult choices that President Ramaphosa has to make. So strong leadership is a must. Committed leadership with real conviction, leadership that has a commitment to popular welfare, as much of Asia has, for example, that's also very important. But you also need strong institutions. And by strong institutions, I mean, you know, parliamentary institutions, judicial institutions, special institutions like public protectors, attorney generals, and so on and so forth, which help to ensure that the executive is checked and balanced as a source of authority and power. And that's why democratic consolidation is a very difficult task, because you've got to go about institution building, and the executive has to be willing to allow its power to be ceded to other institutions in the process. It can't simply have a democracy and then have all the powers as an authoritarian system. And of course, it's very hard to convince leadership to give up on powers and to see this as something good for their countries. But the history of authoritarianism in Africa is that it delivers very little. It delivers a mess. Now, democracy might itself be, I think as Churchill put it, the worst form of government except for all the others. It's also a very fraught process. It's undeniably got some drawbacks, but it's better than all the other systems of government that we've experienced. And the book shows very clearly that the more democratic a country, the better the economic development results. The democracies, in this case, the free countries, grow faster, they have less volatility, so there's the compounding effects of growth are greater, and as a result of this, they're less vulnerable to external change because they are more diversified, they're less dependent on one or two key commodities. So, and that is of course the case because they have better judicial systems, they are more open, they have more respect for human rights and so on, so they're more stable. So it's an overall package. A democracy, it's not just one thing, it's not just an election, a moment in history, and then 4 or 5 or 6 years till the next election. It's about institutions, it's about the full package.
One of the book's chapters deals with the challenges of sustaining democracy. Can you give us a brief explanation of how this challenge played out in Ghana?
Yes, well, of course, in Ghana, there's a country which had a whole sequence of military coups from 1965, and then a period of stability ushered in by the second of Jerry Rawlings' two coups in the early 1980s. He, of course, had a very fierce way, a very violent way of dealing with military, the role of the military in politics, by simply executing all those who were involved in coup d'etats before his coup. And then he went about a process of stabilizing the Ghanaian economy. Although he was seen as a radical, he of course brought the IMF and the World Bank into Ghana in the mid-1980s. And then of course, under civil society pressure, but partly because he also wanted to do it himself, oversaw a period of democratization in Ghana, which occurred with the really, I suppose, the defining point of any point of democratization is when the ruling party loses power at the polls, and that occurred with the election of John Kufuor in 2001. So, and since then, you've slowly seen a process of consolidation, the ruling party losing elections. Kufuor then won one more election. He then, his successor, lost to Atta Mills. Then he died in office, but his successor, John Mahama, lost to the current president, Nana Akufo-Addo. So this turnover of regimes, of political parties, I think illustrates how successful the Ghanaians have been in inculcating a system of democracy that allows political parties to lose and then to come back at some point. And that's what democracy is all about. It's all about establishing a system of competitiveness. And that's why, of course, and competitiveness around ideas. And that's why, of course, democracies tend to perform better in economic terms because investments are safeguarded, there's much more transparency around the rule of law, but also because economic policy is subject to public scrutiny. And that's what the Ghanaians have been able to do so successfully.
It's not only African countries that face the challenges of democratic slippage. Can you give us a brief overview of what happened in Venezuela despite an established democratic system as well as institutions?
Well, Venezuela, of course, Hugo Chavez came into power via a democratic process, and then he ran the country, and his successors have run the country with Nicolas Maduro, essentially using that old mantra, which is to my friends everything, and for my enemies the law. And so he's used the institutions and policies, regimes of government, against his political opponents, and of course used the country's massive oil wealth to attempt, essentially through redistribution, to stay in power, and in so doing destroyed the economy. And as that power has become, as his grip and the Bolivarians' grip on power has become more and more tenuous over time, of course they've resorted to more and more repression, more and more violence, and less of the redistribution, because of course the economy has faltered with the downturn in the oil price and the lack of investment in the oil sector overall in Venezuela. They've used more the repressive tools of government, which we have become all too familiar to us in Africa. They've used those tools of government to stay in power. Control of social media, use of institutions of state, particularly the army and the police and the intelligence services, the harassment of opposition politicians, the house arrest, the detention, and so on and so forth. And I spent several weeks in Venezuela on two separate periods in researching this book as one of the international comparative studies for the book. And it's fascinating to go to Venezuela sort of 4 years apart and to see the change in terms of what's happened in that country. More and more repressive, tougher and tougher economic conditions, but crazy policies that continue as if nothing has changed outside. One of the interviews I undertook was with Maria Machado, in fact gave us a cover puff for the book, a very well-known opposition politician, and the strain was palpable for her to keep sort of democracy, to keep opposition politics alive in such an environment. We shouldn't forget that democracy is not free. A lot of people have had to strive very hard, not least in South Africa, but across our region, in the subcontinent and elsewhere in the world, to keep those democratic flames burning, whether it be the likes of Tendai Biti in Zimbabwe or Olusegun Obasanjo in Nigeria in the 1990s. It's not free. There's a great cost, often a very dramatic cost attached to it by some individuals, and that's currently underway in Venezuela.
You've mentioned that 22 African countries are rated as not free. 13 of these have been consistently authoritarian since 1998. Who is to blame?
Well, you could say the external community is partly to blame, but it's very hard to say that the responsibility in the terms of the system of government entirely lies at the external door of responsibility. Yes, they should put perhaps more spending, more aid money into governance. They should make some aid conditional on democratic governance and those systems and institutions. But it's very hard to change things from outside. The history is littered, particularly in the Middle East, with failed experimentation in terms of regime change from outside. It's Africa itself that has to lead in this regard. And I think what's happened over time is increasingly it's less extra African institutions and governments which matter, it's more African institutions and regimes, especially the African Union, which matters in this regard. And we see this, for example, in one of the case studies in the book is what happened in the Gambia and the way in which ECOWAS intervened to uphold the democratic conditions and the results of the election 2 years ago. And it was the ECOWAS, not the outside world, that essentially called the shots. And I would see over time that increasingly African institutions take responsibility. And you may see that number of 13 shrink fairly dramatically, I would hope, because of the involvement of African institutions, because it makes good sense, not just in terms of human rights, which is extremely important, but it makes absolute sense in terms of systems of governance and transparency to have more accountable, open and transparent systems of government.
Is there a clear link between democracy and economic prosperity in Africa?
Yes, as I've said, there's a big link between the freer the nature of the country and economic performance. It's interesting to note that countries don't democratize because of the extent of their wealth. There's an argument out there that when countries hit $5,000, they can afford to democratize. In Africa, the average wealth where countries democratize is about $1,500. So much poorer than in the rest of the world. So it seems to be that there's no correlation between levels of wealth and whether a country goes the democratic route and how successful it is at consolidating it. But there is a correlation definitely between, and we disaggregated 25 years of economic history in this regard, there's a definite correlation between regime type, free, unfree, partly free, and the nature of economic performance. And particularly if you strip out commodity production from that, in other words, the fact that some countries, even if they are authoritarian, do quite well because they have massive oil reserves, for example, if you strip that out, they do very badly because authoritarian regimes tend to be dependent on one or two commodities and not particularly diversified. The more diversified countries are really reflects the levels of their freedom and thus reflects economic performance and long-term growth prospects over time.
Lastly, you argue that Africans should rewire their political systems. What exactly do you mean by this and how do you think it can be achieved?
Well, we argue that the rewiring is essentially going the democratic route. Africa is at a very crucial juncture. We are about to undergo the greatest demographic change in our continent's history. In Africa, we're going from about 1.2 billion people today to 2.5 billion people in the next generation. In 2050, we'll have 2.5 billion people living in Africa at current rates of growth. And the parents of the 2.5 billionth African have probably already been born. So it's unlikely that this is going to change. What happens in future generations, it does, of course, will reflect economic growth and whether population growth continues in the same vein. So what this means, this huge demographic change, this incredible population growth, it means that the old way of doing things, the sort of business as usual approach, cannot perpetuate if we are to enjoy a different future. And part of that business as usual is, of course, economic policies, but absolutely linked to getting economic policies right is getting the politics right. And we argue in this book that it's crucial in this to introduce more and more democratic systems of government because they are more competitive and they are the best check and balance, however imperfect, on the executive. When they go off the rails, those institutions are able to put them back on the rails, as we've seen in South Africa, with the Public Protector's Report on state capture, with the role of Parliament in the state capture process. It's messy, undoubtedly messy, and very painful. It's not like nice to see this in the public in public view, but it's very important in terms of maintaining the center and maintaining the intact nature of our polity, to coin a phrase, in South Africa, as indeed in the rest of Africa.
That was Greg Mills speaking to Polity about the book titled Democracy Works, Rewiring Politics to Africa's Advantage.